Hi, this is Abhik Majumdar from the National Law University of Odisha at Cuttack. Today I shall talk to you about sedition. Within this, we shall talk about certain specific aspects of sedition, like the definition of sedition, the meaning of the term disaffection, the relationship between sedition and public order, and lastly, the constitutionality of section 124A of the Indian Penal Code. Now, sedition has gained much prominence in the last few years. That is largely due to certain very prominent cases such as those involving Binayak Sen, Arundhati Roy, etc., etc. And to law students, this is surprising for a number of reasons. One, in Kedarnath Singh versus the state of Bihar in 1962, a 5-judge bench of the Supreme Court examined the constitutionality of sedition, especially with respect to the right to free speech guaranteed under Article 19(1)(a), and concluded that the offence may be considered constitutional only if its ambit is confined to those seditious acts intended towards or leading to public disorder. Secondly, in many other legal systems in the international context also, generally sedition is beginning to be regarded as redundant or at worst an affront to the norms of democracy and free speech. Even in the United Kingdom, a Law Commission working paper noted that in the last 15 years, only one case involved charges relating to sedition and concluded that there is no need for an offence of sedition in the criminal code. Let us start with the definition of sedition. There are two ways of understanding this. One is at a conceptual level, which is in terms of how the term has been understood by criminal law theorists and at common law. The second entails how the offence is constituted under Indian statute law. When understanding the first, we encounter a minor impediment. Modern treatises on English criminal law omit to mention it altogether. In books like Padfield, Herring, or the slightly older Bloy and Parry, the word sedition does not occur even once. Wells and Quick carries it exactly twice, both stray references in discussions relating to public order. So, to understand what sedition stood for in common law, we need to examine older literature. Sir Fitzjames Stevens's History of the Criminal Law of England treats sedition not as a single offence, but as a class or category of offences against internal public tranquility, and which comprise of three specific acts, namely seditious words, seditious libels, and seditious conspiracies. These acts comprise one category because they presuppose disaffection with existing government, and the offences themselves consist in the display of this disaffection in the various manners enumerated. From this, it's easy to determine the elements of sedition, namely a presupposition of disaffection, to the display of this disaffection. It is the aspect of display that constitutes the actus reus here. Disaffection with the government forms an aspect of the involved mens rea, in the sense that the acts of display, that is libel, words, etc., must disclose an intention to express or display disaffection of this nature. Stevens's use of descriptors like libel, words, that is slander, suggests a connection with defamation. It is at least clear that, like defamation, sedition also involves communication or expression of some sort, either through written words or spoken words or some other form. Furthermore, this communication or expression itself constitutes the offence, regardless of its effect. Whether or not such display of disaffection leads to a breach of public tranquility is immaterial. Thus, possibly the best way to understand sedition is in terms of a specialized form of defamation, constituting acts of expression intended not to vilify an individual's reputation, but to damage the reputation or goodwill that the state or the government enjoy. The second way to understand sedition, the definition of sedition, is to look at how it's been defined under section 124A of the Indian Penal Code. Now, to begin with, the inclusion of sedition within the Indian Penal Code has had a checkered history. In the Law Commission's draft Penal Code of 1833, popularly credited to Lord Macaulay, section 113 pertained to sedition. But when the Penal Code was enacted in 1860, for some reason the provision was dropped. The precise reason for this is not known, and suggested reasons attributed to questions raised about the Indian legislature's competence to pass such a law, fears that it may unduly curb press freedom, and the possibility that it had simply been overlooked. In any case, the 1870 amendment to the code inserted into the latter section 124A, whose wording was very similar to section 113 of the draft code. In 1898, it was amended further. The main difference between the two versions is that the application of the first was restricted only to inciting or attempting to incite feelings of disaffection towards the government, while the second extended the provision's ambit to also cover hatred or contempt towards the government. Barring minor changes, the 1898 version remains in force to this day. It states, whoever by words either spoken or written or by signs or by visible representation or otherwise brings or attempts to bring into hatred or contempt or excites or attempts to excite disaffection towards the government established by law in India shall be punished with imprisonment for life, to which fine may be added, or with imprisonment may extend to 3 years, to which fine may be added, or with fine. It's interesting to note that while the provision is entitled sedition, its text does not mention the word anywhere. Section 124A can be broken down to two components. One, an intention to cause hatred, contempt or disaffection towards the government, and two, expression of the same through written or spoken words, signs, visible representation or otherwise. I had mentioned earlier that the act of communication or expression completes the offence of sedition. The wordings of 124A bear this out. Phrases such as brings or attempts to bring into hatred and excites or attempts to excite disaffection implies that both successfully inciting hatred or disaffection and mere attempts to do so attract the same levels of culpability, which means that the set of acts required to complete an attempt, that is the act of expression or communication, is itself constitutive of the offence of sedition. And whether or not the accused achieved the purpose or intent behind such communication does not carry much significance, at least as far as conviction is concerned. The wording of section 124A also bears out the connection between sedition and defamation. Section 499, which deals with defamation, begins with the following words: whoever by words either spoken or intended to be read, or by signs or by visible representations, makes or publishes any imputation concerning any person, etc. The resemblance between the two provisions is manifest. It's also evident that the two offences entail essentially similar acts, namely those involving expression or communication. Hence, we may assert that under Indian law also, sedition amounts to a specialized form of defamation, namely one intended to damage the reputation of the state or the government. Lastly, some attention must be given to the punishment specified under section 124A, which provides for imprisonment for up to 3 years, whether simple or rigorous is not stated, or with life imprisonment. 3-year terms are associated with comparatively lesser offences such as rioting, section 148, and causing hurt using dangerous weapons, section 324. Life imprisonment, on the other hand, is awarded for the most serious of offences such as culpable homicide, 304, rape, 375, and so on. To place things in perspective, grievous hurt without the use of dangerous weapons or means, section 325, attracts a maximum term of 7 years, that is considerably more than sedition, but not life imprisonment. Hence, the punishments prescribed in section 124A represent a curious arrangement and certainly one that has few precedents anywhere else. Before we move on to the next topic, we need to look at the explanations given under section 124A. Prior to its amendment in 1898, section 124A contained only one explanation. It clarified that disapprobation of specific governmental measures did not amount to an offence under this section as long as it was consistent with a disposition to render obedience to the authority of the government and to support the lawful authority of the government against any unlawful attempts to resist this authority. This was clearly intended to offer some scope for what was, in that political context, considered legitimate criticism, and to clarify that the purpose of 124A was not to curb the latter. In 1898, this single explanation was replaced by 3 new ones. Explanation 1 construed disaffection as including disloyalty and all feelings of enmity. Explanation 2 excluded from the ambit of this section disapprobation of government measures as long as it sought the lawful alteration of such measures and did not amount to inciting hatred, contempt or disaffection. Explanation 3 extended a similar exclusion to administrative or other action by the government. Like the parent provision, these explanations remain applicable even today. Now we move on to the next topic, that is the ambit of the offence of sedition. The first thing we need to understand here is the meaning of the word disaffection. Certainly, disaffection, the term disaffection, is one of the most contested areas pertaining to the issue of sedition. This is only natural, since the other words used are hatred and contempt, which carry much more harsh connotations and which also carry very clear meanings. The word disaffection is not as harsh as hatred or contempt, nor is its meaning clear. Therefore, its meaning needs to be clarified, and in fact, many judgments have tried to do exactly this. Much of Indian litigation on this issue has focused on the scope and ambit of the term disaffection, and all the more so because, as mentioned earlier, prior to 1898, disaffection constituted the only substantive test the provision contemplated. The Calcutta High Court decision of Queen Empress versus Jogendra Chandra Bose, popularly known as the Bongobashi case, is an important ruling from the pre-1898 era. The significant part of this judgment, more precisely the charge to the jury, hinged upon a contention by counsel that disaffection and disapprobation carried the same meaning, to which Pethram C.J. pointed out somewhat tenuously that this would place all sedition cases within the ambit of the exception and thus reduce the provision to the level of a dead letter. He then ruled that disaffection meant simply the lack of affection, that is, dislike or hatred, whereas disapprobation amounted to merely disapproval. A total of 3 separate sedition-related trials are associated with the great freedom fighter Bal Gangadhar Tilak. The first one dates back to 1897. Though the charge to the jury was published in law reports, it turns out that the published portion comprised only about 1/4 of the document in its entirety. A complete copy of this document is available in the National Archives, from which other researchers have sourced it. But even on the basis of the reported portion, the interpretation given by Justice Strachey to Section 124A has been described as strained in at least 3 different ways. First, instead of adopting a common sense approach to the meaning of disaffection, he adopted a highly technical, in fact, a highly semantics oriented approach. Secondly, the meaning of government established by law was extended also to British rule in its entirety and its representatives as such. Of course, an effort was made to exclude any particular set of administrators. Lastly, he reiterated the Bongobashi interpretation of disaffection as simply the lack of affection, that is to say, hatred or contempt. In 1898, as we know, the provision was amended and the words hatred and contempt added to it expressly. Subsequently, the Bombay High Court in Emperor versus Bhaskar Balwant Bhopatkar chose to reject the Bongobashi and Tilak interpretations and hold that it is not indifference but a positive emotion, and that disaffection is a phrase that is never used with regard to individuals. From this, he concluded the ruler must be accepted as a ruler, and disaffection, which is the opposite of that feeling, is the repudiation of that spirit of acceptance of a particular government as a ruler. This clearly comprised a narrower interpretation and arguably a more lucid one as well. In the second Tilak case, however, Justice Dawar, who was ironically Tilak's counsel back in 1897, chose to place a perverse interpretation on disaffection by stating, "But gentlemen, remember that no publicist, no journalist, no speaker has any authority to attribute dishonest or immoral motives to government." So, from the Tilak trial, we get another definition of disaffection, or should we say one specific characterization of disaffection, which is that attributing dishonest or immoral motives amounts to disaffection and consequently an offence under Section 124A. In the third Tilak trial of 1916, the approach taken by the Bombay High Court was that the question whether or not a speech affects to incite disaffection should be determined not by looking at a few isolated passages, but by viewing the speech as a whole. Using this reasoning, the court acquitted Tilak. The next phase in the development of the law of sedition involves sedition and public order. Several significant sedition-related cases emerged subsequent to the last Tilak decision, not the least of which was Gandhi's trial before the magistrate at Ahmedabad. The next significant development of the law of sedition, however, emerged much later. Moreover, this development needs to be contextualized in the light of certain developments in the English law of sedition. With this, we must at least familiarize ourselves cursorily to understand Indian developments. There is a case called R versus Sullivan, a decision of the Dublin Commission Court, which comprises a suitable example and, as it turns out, a frequently cited one too. It devotes a lengthy passage to the definition of sedition, presented here in considerably truncated form. Sedition embraces all those practices, whether by word, deed or writing, which are calculated to disturb the tranquility of the state and lead ignorant persons to subvert the government and incite the people to insurrection and rebellion. The law considers as sedition all those practices which have for their object to excite discontent or disaffection, to create public disturbance, and generally all endeavors to promote public disorder. Phrases such as all those practices, generally all endeavors, suggest a wide application, but in fact the definition actually narrows the ambit of sedition. If we read the above passage keeping in mind that sedition is merely a form of defamation, then sedition becomes restricted to only those acts of communication or expression that lead to or incite public disorder, incitement, rebellion, etc. This clearly entails a much more stringent standard of proof than the other tests we have encountered so far. For example, attributing dishonest motives to the government may be manifestly seditious according to the criteria formulated in the second Tilak case, but unless the attribution is of such gravity as to intend or lead to public disorder, Sullivan will not be satisfied. This formulation has been adopted by several judgments across the Commonwealth. A prominent example is Boucher versus R, a decision of the Canadian Supreme Court. It relied expressly on this specific passage from Sullivan to acquit a group of Jehovah's Witnesses, holding that pamphlets brought out by the latter did not amount to sedition, since they were neither intended towards nor resulted in public disorder. Niharindu Dutta Mojumdar versus Emperor was the first case on sedition to be decided by the Indian Federal Court. Chief Justice Guyer not only expressly adopted the Sullivan reasoning, but also pointed out that the words used there, like loyalty and disloyalty, may attract criticism due to their non-legal connotations and hence should be understood in the legal sense only. This discloses most certainly an enlightened approach and is all the more remarkable because it was delivered by an English judge in the pre-independence era. However, within a few years, the Privy Council in Emperor versus Sadashiv Narayan Bhale Rao overruled Niharindu on grounds that A, the word sedition does not occur anywhere in the marginal material portion of section 124A, but only in a marginal note and hence should not be invoked to curtail the ambit of the latter, and B, explanation 1 to section 124A clearly renders the provision broad enough to cover all expressions of enmity or disloyalty, not merely those intended towards or leading to public disorder. It then went on to endorse the absence of affections test formulated by Strategy in the first Tilak case and on that basis convicted the accused. Before we go on to the next topic, we also need to look at one major issue which is often overlooked. This is the phrase on or otherwise used in 124A, which is not there in other provisions like 499. So, in section 499, that is defamation, words either written or spoken, signs and visible representations constitute an exhaustive set of criteria, that is, the provision cannot admit as defamatory any act does not fall strictly within their parameters. On the other hand, in section 124A, a similar set of criteria is followed by the general term or otherwise, which render the preceding specific terms only illustrative in character. The question also arises how this general term is to be construed, because clearly the wider the meaning given to it, the more it becomes possible to construe a seditious acts not in the nature of spoken or written words, signs or visible representations. The case law on this point is surprisingly sparse. A perusal of reference works yielded all of two judgments. The first is Re Mylapore Krishnasamy, which holds that sedition can be committed even without spoken or written words, such as through pictures or dramatic performances like dumb shows. The other judgment decided by the Rangoon High Court and referred to in AIR manual only by the citation 1947 Rangoon Law Reports 82 holds that the term "or otherwise" is to be understood in its natural meaning and not in the light of preceding specific terms. So the adjusdem generis principle of interpretation is expressly rejected here. Unfortunately, I was unable to obtain a copy of this judgment or even ascertain its name. In any case, decisions by the Rangoon, now Yangon High Court, do not carry any binding effect in India, which means that the issue of interpreting the "or otherwise" phrase remains entirely open. The next topic is about sedition and post-constitutional developments. As noted earlier, the essence of sedition lies in criminalizing certain form of expression. Article 19(1)(a) of the Constitution guarantees free speech and expression and so applies squarely to the issue of sedition. Initially, Article 19(2) contemplated as an exception to free speech only grounds connected with the security of the state. This raised the question whether sedition and other curbs on free speech on grounds of public order could be protected under the former. The Supreme Court examined this issue in two judgments passed on the same day and by the same bench, namely Brijbhushan versus State of Delhi and Ramesh Thapar versus State of Madras. The majority opinions in both cases were delivered by Patanjali Shastri J, who held that sedition or other threats to public order did not constitute a threat to state security and therefore did not enjoy the protection of Article 19 Clause 2. Justice Fazal Ali delivered dissenting judgments in both instances, where he held that sedition did constitute a threat to state security and therefore did enjoy protection under Article 19 Clause 2. Subsequently, the First Amendment to the Constitution added other grounds to Article 19 Clause 2, including friendly relations with foreign states, public order, and decency and morality. Now the question transformed into whether, and if so, to what extent, the public order criterion protects the constitutionality of sedition and Section 124A. The Supreme Court addressed this authoritatively in the decision called Kedarnath Singh versus State of Bihar, which I had mentioned earlier. Chief Justice Sinha, speaking for the court, quoted with approval extracts from Sullivan, which we've already encountered, and R versus Aldred, and then embarked on a detailed discussion of the conflict between Niharendu and Sadashiv Narayan, and then the inputs of Brijbhushan and Ramesh Thapar. It identified Niharendu and Sadashiv Narayan as representatives of two possible interpretations of Section 124A, the first restricting the provision to only public order, and the second interpreting it broadly to include all instances of lack of affection. The court noted that any law not protected by Article 19 Clause 2 is necessarily ultra vires Article 19 Clause 1A, and moreover, Article 19 Clause 2 offered protection only to laws upholding public order or any other grounds mentioned therein. Hence, if Section 124A were interpreted to include all forms of disaffection and not merely threats to public order, then it would no longer be protected by Article 19 Clause 2 and would hence become unconstitutional. On the other hand, if Section 124A were to be interpreted in the lines of Niharendu to extend only to public order, then it would be saved from unconstitutionality by 19 Clause 2. Following RMD Chamarbagwala's case, it held that if the impugned provisions of a law come within the constitutional powers of the legislature by adopting one view of the words of the impugned section or act, the court will take that view of the matter and limits its application accordingly in preference to the view which would make it unconstitutional on another view of the interpretation of the words in question. That is to say, if a law can be interpreted in two different ways, and one is constitutional, the other is ultra vires the constitution, then the court will prefer that interpretation which is constitutional and subsequently interpret the provision according to that specific interpretation. Hence, to save Section 124A from unconstitutionality, it must be interpreted narrowly to cover only public order and nothing more. Now, we conclude this by looking at certain developments in the law of sedition after Kedarnath Singh. Now, this appears slightly surprising because after Kedarnath Singh's authoritative pronouncement, one would have thought that the parameters of sedition have been defined for once and for all. Initially, at least, subsequent cases on sedition tended to rely considerably on Kedarnath Singh. One example is the Gujarat High Court decision in Manubhai Tribhuvandas Patel versus State of Gujarat, which concerned a book of the communist leader Mao Zedong's speeches. Chief Justice Bhagwati, speaking for the court, pointed out that after Kedarnath Singh, it must therefore be taken as well settled that words, deeds or writing constitute sedition punishable under Section 124A only if they incite violence or disturb law and order or create public disorder or have the intention or tendency to do so. After examining the text, he concluded that there is not a word in these passages, that is extract from speeches, which even remotely suggests that people should overthrow lawfully established government by force or violence. In Bilal Ahmed Kalu versus State of Andhra Pradesh, we find the beginnings of a disturbing trend. Here, the Supreme Court held that merely spreading news about atrocities committed by Indian Army personnel on Kashmiri Muslims did not amount to sedition. What is interesting is the observation that in the charges framed against him, there is not even a suggestion that the appellant did anything against the government of India or any other government of the state. Hence, leave alone the evidence against the accused, if even the charges framed cannot sustain a conviction, then on what basis did the lower courts convict him? Not surprisingly, the Supreme Court was moved to record strong remarks about the trial court's very casual approach in this regard. This trend is only exacerbated in Nazir Khan versus State of Delhi. Here, the appellants were accused of carrying out acts of terrorism like kidnapping foreign nationals. The Supreme Court reaffirmed, among other things, their conviction for sedition. This it did so on the basis of a lengthy definition provided in para 37, which construed the offence in terms of any act intended to or calculated to create public disturbance or lead to civil war, to bring into hatred or contempt the sovereign or the government, etc. At least two problems may be discerned in this court's rationale. First, it makes no reference to Sullivan, from which this definition has been sourced more or less verbatim. Secondly, what Sullivan and other judgments, including Niharendu and Kedarnath Singh, have said about public order has to be understood in the larger context of what sedition actually is, namely a form of defamation. Hence, it's not enough that the impugned acts disturb public order. What sedition requires is that the disturbance be effected not through violence, but through writing, speeches, and other forms of expression alone. It is thus difficult to appreciate how kidnapping foreign nationals can lead to hatred, contempt, or disaffection towards the government, as even the bare text of Section 124A stipulates. Binayak Sen's case has garnered much publicity. A trial court in Chhattisgarh convicted him on sedition on the basis of findings that allegedly seditious documents were found in his possession, that he was a member of Naxalite organizations, and he had acted as a courier for an imprisoned Naxalite leader. Far from observing the limitations set by Kedarnath Singh, the trial court judgment does not even mention the latter anywhere. Similarly, take the case registered against the noted writer and activist Arundhati Roy. She had made certain remarks on Kashmiri independence. Now, newspaper reports suggest that the police were initially reluctant to prosecute because according to their counsel, it fell within the parameters laid down in Kedarnath Singh and therefore could not be construed as seditious. Even the report submitted by the police to the magistrate points out this fact. Yet the magistrate chose to order prosecution, holding that after giving my thoughtful consideration to the submissions made and to the material on record, I have come to the conclusion that the complaint clearly discloses the commission of cognizable offences. Her 12-page report does not mention the Kedarnath Singh judgment even once. Lastly, let us summarize what we've looked at so far. The development of sedition law in India may be summarized as a debate about its scope and ambit. Initially, it was given a wide construction, and disaffection was held to mean dislike or hatred. In the second Tilak case, a specific instantiation was given, namely attributing dishonest or immoral motives to the government. Niharendu represents a contrary approach, which restricts the ambit of sedition to only such acts of expression which are intended towards or lead to public disorder and not merely disaffection. Though Sadashiv Narayan overruled this decision, subsequently Kedarnath upheld it on grounds that only such a restrictive interpretation will attract the protection of 19 clause 2 and thus save it from Article 19(1)(a) of the Constitution. In recent times though, courts have tended to stray away from Kedarnath Singh. They have not only interpreted sedition in unduly wide terms, but also reached guilty verdicts in cases where the facts are altogether unrelated to the parameters of sedition. Why this happens remains a mystery. Thank you.